Okay. Welcome, everyone. First of all, our online audience, thanks for joining us for another Vienna Artist talk here live from Vienna. I am very pleased to introduce to you some really great, beautiful minds from the cultural and tourism sector. Let me introduce you to Sabine Haag. She's the Director General from the Kunsthistorische Museum. Certainly one of the four or five top museums in the world. Sabine, welcome, and thanks so much for joining us here this afternoon. Then we have from Toronto, Gail Lord from Lord Cultural Resources. She's the founder and the CEO of certainly one of the most important cultural strategy advisors working worldwide on museum projects and also cultural centers. Gail, really a pleasure to have you here. Good morning. Hope it's not too early for you.
No, it's just time for a coffee.
Yes, we would like to invite you for a Viennese coffee next time when we can do analog meetings again.
Looking forward to it. Thank you.
And then we have also Norbert Kettner. I'm pleased, Norbert, thanks so much for joining us. You are Director General from the Viennese Tourist Board, and not only an expert in tourism, but also in his former position, an expert in creative industries, I would like to say and mention. We have faced some really difficult times, and some people say that especially the cultural sector, also tourism and the creative industries, the sectors that are most hit and most terrible hit by the virus, by the pandemic. And I would like to start perhaps with Sabine, how you experienced this crisis the last couple of weeks, month. I'm glad to see that you're open again, but some of your colleagues give me really bad news. The Metropolitan, for example, is calculating a loss of 100 to 150,000, no, millions of dollars due to the lockdown. Having to sack 80 people, Philadelphia Museum the same, and many other institutions are not even open yet. How did you cope during this crisis, and how is it going with the reopening now?
Well, thank you, Robert, and welcome also to our audiences from my side. I'm very happy to speak a little bit about the effects of the pandemic for the Kunsthistorisches Museum and the other two museums that are partners in our group, the Ethnographic Museum and the Theater Museum. And for us, the pandemic really struck us as a catastrophe, I could say, because up until March 11, every year has been better than the previous one. And so we were really on a very, very successful way. And then all of a sudden, of course, the whole world was struck by the pandemic. We had to close almost immediately all our museums, and which was on March 11, and then of course at the same time, 1 week later, we sent all our staff. We have about I would say 700 people working for in all our museums. They had to be sent to telework, home office, and starting in April 1st, for 3 months, we were able to send them, or most of them, to short time work, and only like security people, IT people, and a few others remain.
And the director,
of course, it would not have been plausible if the director had gone to short-time work. And so we have had three months of short-time work, which means that in April, and we had a model in April and May, our staff who was on short-time work had zero work, and only in June we had sent 30% of the hours that they would normally do, just to get ready to reopen our museums on July 1st. And on the other hand, 80% of the staff costs were paid by the state. So this really helped us to you know, for our cash management, to pay our bills, to pay the wages and everything. And in the meantime, of course, we did some kind of maintenance work and things like this. But we know that the real problem for us will start when we reopen our museums again, because when you look at the statistics of our visitors, about 80% of our visitors are tourists, and only 20 are locals or people living in Austria. Mm-hmm. And of course, this high percentage of tourists, which we are very proud of, because we're not a nationalist museum or national museum, but we really have world art, of course, also is a result of the great collaboration with Vienna Tourism, for example, that we were part of this really, really great success story of bringing the cultural life of Vienna into the world. And now, of course, due to the lockdown and the borders are closed, we are in a completely different situation. So at the moment, how is the situation in the museum? We reopened the Kunsthistorisches Museum, the main building, at Pentecost, end of May. And of course, the visitors' numbers are really low. I mean, we have about, I would say, maybe 15% of our regular visitors, if we compare it to what happened a year ago. And of course, we have a huge gesture of welcome to the local audiences. And now, of course, also that the borders to the eastern borders are reopening again, and the borders to Germany, the situation is improving a little bit. But we sense that it will take at least 2 or 3 more years until we will probably be back to the numbers of visitors. And of course, we had to readapt our program. We had to postpone some of our big exhibitions until fall or even next year. And we're really looking very, very closely at all our costs. And we have, because we have no message so far from the ministry, to which extent they will help us cover the costs that arose from the pandemic. So this is actually our situation at the moment, which on the one hand, I mean, the really very good news is that museums have to be open, according to my opinion. So when we were able to open at least one of our locations, couple of weeks ago, that was really a huge relief for us. But on the other hand, of course, it's still not a very happy situation to see not too many visitors in the galleries.
And have you done now like a special outreach to the local audience, as it's so important at this point?
Yes, I think, I mean, I personally think it's good for us now to really address the local audiences with many different ways, and to really put the focus on the locals. I think we probably have neglected them in the past, maybe a little bit in favor of our international visitors. So I think it's really now the time for outreach. Of course, the schools are closed at the moment, so we will only can start with school programs again in fall. But I think we still will do some outreach programs with our art education. We will go into the different districts of Vienna and do art education there, and different kinds of activities. And personally, I think it's a very good moment at the moment to visit museums, because it's not, you know, really the hysteric way to look at art, but you know, you have, it's quiet, it's cool, it's climatized, and of course everyone is safe. I mean, you can decide whether you want to wear masks or not, so it's really up to you, which I think is a good thing to do. So we really encourage our visitors to come to enjoy and to take their time. We have, of course, special offers with our annual ticket and other things. And I really can only encourage people to come now that traveling is so limited. Go and enjoy culture. That's what I really want to stress.
Sabine, we're gonna visit you soon. Next week for sure. I promise. Gail, Sabine has given us a great overview, I think, of her institution, of the Kunsthistorisches Museum, and the challenges she faced. Can you give us a little bit some insights on the impact you and your clients face, and on a broader international level, perhaps, that you were working recently?
Yeah, I'll try.
What are the most important points that are raised right now on the strategic level, et cetera?
Yeah, I'll try. So thank you, and thank you, Sabine. It was a great great overview of one of my favorite museums. I remember making my pilgrimage there when I was 18 years old to see the collection, and I've been many times since, obviously. And thank you to all the people. Norbert, good to see you again. And all the people watching, it's pretty impressive. I even see some names of a few people that I know. Mm-hmm. So from my own individual perspective, I'm the president of a company. So we have employees. They're all working from home. I probably everybody on this call is fairly familiar with what that is. I could speak a little bit about museums in Canada, the United States, and to some degree colleagues in the Netherlands. The museums are still closed for the most part. Certain states, they're open. Certain provinces in Canada, they're open. These large geographic countries tend to make decisions on regional and provincial or state lines. And so there isn't really a consistent pattern. I know that, by the way, in the Netherlands, they have been open for a while. They're very successful in using online ticketing as a way. Not so much, I think this is maybe becoming universal, that the online ticketing used to be seen as a way of earning money and doing the kind of ticketing, which is you could be cheaper in the morning, more expensive in the peak hours. Now, really, the online ticketing is very important for assuring safety, assuring that you can control the number. And so that's a very, very important strategy, which the data from the National Museums in the Netherlands is actually that they're expecting to be at about 30% of their normal, regular, if you like, historic levels. Kind of the United States, it's a little bit of a different problem. The United States, as you know, relies less on government funding, although there is government funding, common misconception that there is no government funding. And so the mixed economy approach and the private approach, again, has a kind of uneven quality. Canada is halfway between Europe and the United States in all things. And so we also have a mixed economy, but again, much more reliant on government funding. And I should say that the 80%, Sabine, that you talked about is like only a dream over here. The highest level right now, and it shifted when I started my career in museums, which is more than a few years ago, our museums in Canada were at an 80% subsidy level. Now it's roughly the national level, roughly 50%, 60%. So you can see the shortfall from private funding and visitor income is actually quite significant. Both the Canada Council, which is a national granting agency, of the Canadian government, and the Americans for the Arts, which is like a National Arts Council type of organization, they've done big surveys to find out how much money is really being lost. I mean, this is you read numbers, and they're fairly in the arts and generally, and the numbers are completely unreliable. So one estimate is $4.5 billion in the United States. Well, that's ridiculously low. I mean, that was a survey of only 11,000 institutions. So the aid grants have been, in a way, they sound large, but in fact, they're very modest. So in the United States, there's been an aid grant of around $300 million from the national government in Canada, which is one-tenth of the size of the United States, but in population. Our government has come forward with a grant in aid of $500 million, which is slightly more reasonable. But I think that the situation of when will there be a return to international travel is actually a very big question. There are many different emphases. I think that for the metropolitan areas that have, like Vienna, for example, that has a large drive possibility, people can come short distances and fairly large population, I think you're entirely right. It's to focus on the local market. I'll just say, though, that later in the discussion, I'd like to talk about the fact that I think we have to have a complete rethink of how arts are funded, because there's something fundamentally wrong. It was fundamentally wrong before, and it's going to be fundamentally wrong after, but we'll get into that.
Okay. Thank you, Gail, for this outlook from the Americas. Norbert, you have been running from one great news, one record visitor number for many, many years. I think just last year you had like 17 million nights, a plus 6% again. And now I was just studying some of the statistics. In May, just in May, tourist arrivals were down 98%. It's like mind-boggling, no? And the hotel occupancy rate is at 4.5%. Coming from such a successful period, how did you cope with this amazing crisis, with this tremendous crisis?
Yeah. Good afternoon, good morning to Toronto. Yes, great to see you all. I would like to start with my personal soundtrack to the crisis, because we had our annual press conference for the most successful year 2019 on January 22nd. Mm-hmm. And I remember well, one of the last questions was, there's something going on in a Chinese province. Do you think this will affect us in any way? And I said, I think it's a regional thing, and I think everything is quite well managed. So about talking about fundamental misjudgments, so I have to contribute some of this misjudgment, because we could never believe that something like the COVID-19 crisis would happen. To give you an idea, we talk about, only in Vienna, we talk about a sector which contributes 4 billion euros to the GDP, to the city's GDP. Tourists in Vienna spend 645 million per annum for cultural activities. Wow. Talk about 116,000 jobs in the city, which are linked directly to tourism. So yes, it's a huge sector. It's a huge interdependency, tourism, culture, tourism, gastronomy, tourism, retail, for instance. Yeah. And now we have a total loss, actually. Normally our occupancy is about 80% in hotels. Now we have about 10 to 15%. And this will not improve dramatically this year. So we see recovery at the beginning of 2021, but we will not reach the levels of before 23 or 24. So there are some major changes will go on, but on a more positive view, I think that people, that's what we see, and we were in contact with all our partners and clients, the whole crisis. So we were on an always on mode with all our partners in 17 countries in the world. What we are seeing, I think this is quite comforting, that people are craving for life experiences, whether it's traveling, mm-hmm. whether it's the arts and culture. So I'm a great admirer of digitization, and we saw what digitization could do during, it helped us all during the crisis. But it will never be a substitute to the real life experience. And I think this is quite comforting. That does not mean that we should not have a closer look on means of digitization. I think this is very important. But it's a thing, what we in tourism did for many years already. So every step of the customer journey has to be mirrored in the digital world. Mm-hmm. And I think this is a thing which will be even more important for cultural institutions to as a teaser for the real-time experience. Mm-hmm. So there are some positive, not positive thing, but some optimistic views about the whole thing. But I think we will face major changes. But also on an optimistic side, I think that culture is a very positive fuel for tourism. Because yes, we talk about imbalanced tourism, too many people in some institutions, yes. We won't have these troubles and these problems for many years now. But still, we never had any complaints about behavior of tourists because it's a different kind of tourism. We mm-hmm. have we have the two Ks, it's overseas, it's culture and Congress. Mm-hmm. These are the most important sectors in Vienna. And I think with this, we are on a quite positive side, actually. But this year, we are all in a survival mode. Making business is about survive this year. And then the years to come, we will see new heights, actually. I believe that.
Mm-hmm. Norbert, you mentioned that you see some major changes coming up, and I wonder what this kind of changes might be. You mentioned digitalization is one, perhaps, but perhaps you can give us some more examples. And also, I would like to have Sabine and Gail also join in, and what kind of major changes you would foresee, and perhaps also changes that might be necessary. You know, in think about tourism, some people already are talking about over tourism, which is not an issue anymore, but still might become an issue again. In the cultural field, for example, Jane Carlier just recently criticized heavily this kind of biennale inflations and art fair inflations and also overcrowded museums, etc., from an experience point of view. Other changes on a strategic level, like Norbert, I think you just presented last year the new strategy, 5-year plan for the development of tourism in Vienna. What kind of strategies, changes might come up and are perhaps really necessary? Sabine, you mentioned the stronger reach out to a local community and involving the local community better, and also, of course, the virtual community. Any other changes you see?
Is it Norbert, or shall I say a few words?
I wanted to still have Norbert because he brought up
the okay. Yes. Okay. Yeah, sure, and then.
So, then also Sabine and Gail from your point of view.
Yeah. I'm not the real expert in this field, but I could imagine that there in the culture, in the arts, when we talk about big exhibition, that there might something coming up like a new touring culture. Because when you bring together the greatest pieces from several collections on a continent, I think for ecological and other reasons, it would be smart to have one exhibition touring a continent and not just bringing pieces from all over the world for one exhibition on one continent and then going back to their home galleries. So maybe this could be a thing, that a new sort of continental touring for big exhibitions, so that there are more collaboration between cultural institutions, which would say, okay, Amsterdam, Vienna, and Paris, we decide to bring, to make together a big exhibition on a certain theme. And this exhibition does not only take place once on the continent, but on three locations. So for ecological reasons, for logistical reasons, maybe this could be a change. But mm-hmm. I'm not the expert on this field, so there.
And specifically in the
talk about that.
No, but then specifically the tourism industry, what changes did you think about when you mentioned those?
What we already anticipated in our strategy is that the means of transport will change, mm-hmm. especially for domestic market or neighboring markets. So already 1 year ago, we said that whenever you can take a train and have a ride of 7 hours, do it and don't step on an airplane.
So again, touching on the ecological crisis. And
Yes. I think this is one of the outcomes. We are not a naive. 80% of our guests come from abroad. Mm-hmm. And Vienna is the number three city for Chinese guests, or used to be the number three city for Chinese guests in Europe after Paris and London. Mm-hmm. So we need planes also in the future. But there will be shifts. And I think it's also about orientating more on real necessities and needs of people, like culture, what I believe is a very basic need for people. Meeting, business meetings, congresses. So I always say city tourism and cultural tourism is on the on the bright side of the tourism moon. Mm-hmm. We saw in the last month that there are some darker sides of tourism as well. Mm-hmm. And I think this is a good basis for going into a hopefully better future.
Mm-hmm. Sabine, changes you foresee, and necessary changes perhaps also in the museum world?
Well, I think the museum world and our activities will change quite a bit. First of all, Norbert was talking about the digitization. During the pandemic, of course, when it was not possible to visit the museum physically, the museum had to go to the audiences in a digital way. And now that we are reopening again, I think both kinds of museums will coexist. Of course, there is strong urge and I strongly believe in the analogous way of experiencing art, of enjoying it, of you know, the emotional way of enjoying art. So there will always be a visit to the museum, but also the digital museum, of course, will also be there. And it's a matter of resources. Norbert also mentioned the exhibition business. I think the exhibition business will change quite a bit, not only for climate reasons, but also for climate reasons, also for economic reasons. And I think we will probably have less exhibitions. There will be an even stronger focus on collaboration. The duration of exhibitions might extend, not 3 months, but rather 4, 5, 6 months, something like this. And there will be more collaboration, let's say, between European museums. We will certainly have a look at loans from overseas, because that will be expensive. Will be, you know, everyone looks at the climate aspect also, you know, what this would mean. And I believe there will be a much stronger focus on the collections themselves. So museums will go more deeply into their collections, which, for example, for our museum will be quite a good way to dive in, because, you know, we have this almost encyclopedic collections. And I think it will. We will put new topics, new questions to the collections, more also from a contemporary way of looking, to see how do, for example, old masters, what do they, how do we look at them from, you know, from a contemporary view. So of course much more a conversation with the audiences, with the local audiences. It will be much slower, I guess, because none of us will have the big budgets, at least not for the next 2 or 3 years, I would say. But for our museum, I think it's still very important not to fall back on don't understand it in a negative way. We don't want to become too provincial. We are an international museum, and we still want to collaborate with our international partners, with our international networks, with our international research partners, tourism partners, and so on. So I still think that we just have to look at it in a fresh way.
And also, measuring success, you know, in the last many years, it was always, okay, how many visitors you can attract. Mm-hmm. As this metrics doesn't work anymore, are there some new metrics now you foresee that
more? Well, I think, yeah, you probably will look more on the impact of what you do. And of course, the number of visitors will certainly not be the only kind of number that is interesting. Yeah. And of course, for us, we are a federal museum, but what so many people don't know, more than 50% of our budget, of our income, our revenue comes from our own activities. Less than 48% is the budget that is given to us from the state. And the state, of course, will give us less and less, I'm quite sure. But we have to remind them, of course, that the museums, the objects, and everything is not owned by the museum, but actually by the state. So we have to find a better understanding about this. And as I said before, I think we will have a much closer look at the impact of our activities, not only in a financial way, but also what does it mean to society. I strongly believe that it is necessary and elemental for a functioning society, for a healthy society, that it takes part also in cultural activities. And this, of course, means that we have to connect in a better way. But not only for our local audiences, we still want to keep going international. That's yeah, for sure.
All right. Gail, would you like to add some more issues concerning this kind of strategic changes that might happen past and post Corona?
Right. Okay. So I'll divide my remarks in maybe three categories to simplify, because I have such great colleagues on this panel. First, about tourism, I'd like to talk a little bit about technology. And then the third, I'd like to talk about the intellectual content of what we're all about. So I'll try and talk quickly, but still, I think that there's so many issues here. So on the subject of tourism, of course, the big cities are suffering. Of course, where there was biggest tourism, now we have the biggest fall. On the other hand, I think that the tourism strategies in every country now have to really focus also on the small communities, because the small community will stand to simply die. And because the impact, or they don't have other industries in many cases, or they're rural, or they're farming, or they have very limited cultural resources, as the cultural resources are not shared equally. And so I think it's terribly important that every country, including my country, has to focus on saving the small communities. Had fewer tourists, but now perhaps they have nothing. And this idea of staycation really does need to be promoted, because when tourism comes back, those small communities, their local festivals and so on, they may no longer really exist. And that's a real danger. I mean, it's a population danger, because in a sense, it's not just about the tourism industry, it's also about the intellectual stimulation that it brings.
So you see the biggest risk not for like major capitals like Vienna and major institutions.
No, they're mainly capital cities. If they're capitals of countries, you know, we have to understand countries can print money. It's called quantitative easing. There are many different strategies. They're not all desirable. Some say they're inflationary. Some say not. But actually, it's the smaller communities that are very much endangered and very much at risk. It's not that there's no problem in the big cities. Actually, I would argue, and this is Arts Week, and so I think we should spend a little time talking about artists and how artists are also suffering. Mm-hmm. The amount of unemployment of artists is really a crisis. And, governments have come in all the countries that I know of, different kind of handouts. You know, there's, I don't know the situation in your country, but in Canada, even in the United States, certainly in Berlin, we read about it in Germany a lot, that there are funds for artists. These are very meager and very, very small amounts of money that are barely at a survival level. And this really does take me to a little bit of a view of the future. Human beings, museums do much good on this, have very short memories. We have always lived with pandemics. We have always had crises. We've had even worse, we've had wars. Obviously, Austria is no small witness to the kind of disruption that war brings. And yet we have such short memories of these things. We didn't remember the biggest influenza epidemic in 1918-1919, which killed more people than the First World War. So, you know, the frightening thing here is that we actually forget what is at the base of all this. And I think we have to talk a little bit and realize that there has been a real shift in the art world and the history world as well in the last 40 years from a kind of a vision of the and humanities, which was based on a way of life, if you like, an intellectual enterprise. You can see this on the side of FDR and the New Deal for the arts that he brought in as a solution to the big crisis of the 1920s. So 1935, roughly to 1943, something like that. We have a New Deal of art going on in the United States. We have the Bauhaus in Germany, and these processes really envisioned a way of art that was more part of a way of life. The key thing is, artists worked with museums, museums worked with artists as well, to create meaning on a very broad popular plane. It didn't have tourism, but it was a much broader plane. Now, what's interesting to me is that in the, I wanna say 1980s, 1990s, we moved to a much more market-oriented approach to the arts. And I'm a big believer in cultural, don't get me wrong. I'm one of the first people to write on the subject going back into the 1980s. The reality is that the art market has been ruling everything for 50 years, and it changes the valuation of what we all do, away from a Bauhaus ideal, or maybe even the Vienna Secession. Art's not quite the same thing, certainly. And so I think what we're seeing in the world today now is a demand for a new deal for the arts, where artists and cultural workers actually would be salaried. You know, artists don't particularly want handouts. They don't particularly want to live from the art market, although some are hugely successful. That's great for them. And I think we have to reset of the role of art in our society. And I kind of think that Vienna Art Week, especially being in Vienna, is a nice place to consider that. So we can all put band-aids on this problem. But don't you think that this pandemic is giving us the chance to rethink? And plus, as my two colleagues said, the availability of new technology means that it's more possible than ever. So that's my thought.
Well, that's that would be already a very nice closing word, a new deal for the art. And I think it's, you mentioned the artists, actually, Vienna Art Week this year, the main focus is the artist scenes, and with our open studio program. And we also have asked all our program partners from Kunsthistorische to Secession to really put a focus on the locally working artists here. And you mentioned this kind of support systems and handouts from politics. This is done here in Austria too, but definitely think about the average income of an artist here in Austria, about 5,000 or 15,000 euros a year, like net income. Definitely the precarious state we had before already is certainly aggravated right now. In that sense, politics, Sabine and all of you, the reaction of politics here in Vienna, our State Secretary for Culture had to resign. Do you see now an adequate response by politics? Gail urges much more involvement, much more engagement. How do you see that situation now? Sabine, I think there was like a fast funding scheme now for museums for some alleviation until September, I think, something I heard, I was reading. How did you get the response from politicians to this crisis? How do you see
that? I mean, it was really embarrassing, I have to say, that culture, arts and culture only came in at the last moment into the political discussion. They were talking about, I don't know what, but never talked about arts and culture, even though, as we all know, and as we all mentioned, arts and culture are so important for Austria, not only intellectually, but also in economically and many other ways. And so finally, when the politicians started to consider the field of arts and culture and the effects of the pandemic, it was very late, I would say. And of course, it was understandable that they were first helping the artists, the smaller institution, the nonprofit, and so on. And then finally, they also thought about the museums. And our new Secretary of State for Culture, of course, was very hands-on, well-connected, and of course, politics also knew that they had to support in some ways. And so this was, I would say, the starting point when Andrea Meyer arrived on the scene. And she has been successful, but I mean, there is still a very, very long way to go. Mm-hmm. And also there, we have to still discuss a strategy, how this will work, not only on the spot, just for a first aid, but how shall arts and culture be working and functioning and be financed in the future, in the next few years. And I think we're still on the beginning of the road, I would say. And of course, there are many small steps that have to be considered. And of course, also the larger institutions like the Federal Museums, we have to do our share. That's obvious. But I think there has to be a much stronger support and willing for at least a midterm strategy on how arts and culture should be an integral part of Austria. And so we're quite hopeful, of course, that we will be invited for the dialogue or for the discussions. But it's we're really only at the beginning, I would say.
Norbert, would you like to add?
Yeah, I only can agree. I think we got some momentum after the change of staff in the department. I think a major thing is that what I call the anyway times are over. Culture is here anyway. Freedom of travel is here anyway. Gastronomy is here anyway. And I think this was the trap of it. Because everybody thought we are very spoiled in this country with culture. And culture was here anyway. So it was one of the last aspects which were considered in the crisis, at the beginning of the crisis. And I think nothing is here anyway. Yeah. And you fight for many things because nothing is here anyway. And Sabine mentioned before also that we have to be careful that the crisis does not limit us in our way of thinking, that we should not lose our cosmopolitan approach to things. Because Gail mentioned before the pandemic 100 years ago, and I fully agree what you said, but there was one effect which was not so prominent because everything was forgotten very soon. We had the roaring 20s afterwards, but until 1914, the world was very globalized, much more globalized than we now know nowadays. And the pandemic really, not only the First World War, but also the pandemic brought a real disruption to this globalization before the First War.
Very interesting.
And I think we should take care that we don't lose the good aspects of globalizations. Also in social matters, I think that women, minorities have to take really care of what's happening now, because there will be some tendencies under the in the brackets of healthy, local, normal, which will bring certain groups under pressure. Certain And I think we have to take care. We have to be very cautious with this, because and such tendencies immediately affect arts and culture. Uh-huh. And one sense that one anecdote, and forgive me my very technical approach. I at the beginning of the discussion I was that you know that the culture is our only image factor in the world. We have great companies, we have great entrepreneurs, but they are always overshadowed by our culture, by our cultural past, but also our cultural present. And I was brought the anecdote when I, together with my colleagues from Germany and Switzerland, we go abroad, what we sometimes did, to China or Japan or US. My German colleagues would say, we come from the country where the greatest cars are built. My Swiss colleagues would say, I come from watch country. And I said, I come from culture country. And you can discuss it or not, whether this is just a marketing spin, but this was reality. And it was very astonishing that this sector was completely forgotten in the beginning.
Very important, I think, soft power through culture. I think Gail wrote a very interesting book about it. Also, and also, I also think about your mentioning of culture, the arts, not only visual arts, but as at the museum, as a place where utopia, and in that sense also inclusion and forward thinking and critical thinking can take place. I think it's also very important, I think, post-corona times. Gail, one comment still, and then I have one or two questions perhaps from the audience, and then we are coming to an end, unfortunately, already. We could have continued to, it's very interesting to continue, but we have to come to an end. Gail.
Well, I think that, you know, I have a very rare opportunity to have such excellent co-panelists, and I really want to thank you and a great moderator. I think that the opportunity, those of us all, I think, have been sort of locked down for the last few months. We've been able to enjoy international culture like never before. Sitting in our homes. Of course, I agree, it's not the same as being there. But then, you know, it was only 10% of the world population that ever had a chance to be in all these places anyway. So we really need to have an eye on democratization and access and how technology and the institutions and tourism are going to work together. And of course, people know I'm a private consultant in the private sector, but I'm also working with the University of Toronto on a city cultural center initiative to really look at how can cultural relationships be reset for what remains of the 21st century, which is certainly what we expected it was going to be about. And to look at some of these different transitions and traditions. And Norbert, I really appreciate what you said. I never thought about it before, but there was a reaction, long-lasting and very dangerous one around human health. I think that's very I think you're maybe pointing to a potential rise of fascism, things of this sort that we're seeing. We have to remember that the problems that we're seeing now as a result of the pandemic were in more than an embryonic form before the pandemic. And so I think us all working together, and maybe this opens up to the questions, is really the next stage of history for all of us who are privileged to survive. Mm-hmm. Of course. So thanks.
So, thank you, Gail. You're talking not about the corona crisis, but also social divide, economic crisis, many crises we face. But still, let me just get two questions from the audience. One is, how do you think museums and cultural institutions can transform the increase in digital visitors into real life visitors? That is one question. Another question is, what is the largest barrier to museums and cultural institutions behaving more like traditional for-profit companies? How can they diversify their revenue streams and become less like financing schemes, diversify their revenue streams and become less dependent on government funding in this new COVID and post-COVID context? And a last question, how do you see the logistics of museums change and evolve as a result of COVID-19, such as audio guides, visitor sanitation, social distancing, crowd control, ticketing, etc.? Perhaps Sabine, could you start and then anyone who wishes to join in?
Well, maybe the last question first. Of course, we see that people are much more cautious when they come to the museum. The contactless visit to the museum, I think, will accompany us for a while. So I think people will probably be very reluctant to take audio guides. They would rather have their app or use their own device. They would probably prefer personal tours, which I always think are a very good way to experience museums. So we still have to, really improve and think and also watch closely our visitors, how they behave, and really listen to them when they write down in the feedback book or something what their needs are. Talking about digitization, as I said before, on the one hand, it should the digital programs and activities of the museums should focus on giving maybe a deeper look behind the scenes, have like great websites, like for example our Inside Bruegel website, where you can really, you know, go into detail and look at details in paintings which you will never see with the free eye when you go and visit the museum, or things like this. So it's all about storytelling, I guess,
yeah.
To keep people interested. And then, of course, we also we have to accept that there are lots of people who will never be able to visit museums, but they should not be excluded from the experience of the arts and what can be seen in a museum. And I think, again, this is where we have to exchange ideas and closely communicate with other institutions, with other museums, what they are doing, what programs or activities are successful. Not every museum has to invent everything from the scratch, I would say.
Mm-hmm. And again, concerning, you mentioned that about the new finance, other financing schemes, and financing is a big issue past the COVID.
Just to be brief, I'd like to build on what Sabine said. I think that the internet is almost the best thing that's happened in to the arts and to museums in this COVID period. I think that we need to understand that in the future, our visitation will be 50% online, 50% on site. And that overall huge increase. The arts have benefited from the fact that there has been no professional sport virtually on television for the last 3 or 4 months. And people don't talk about this enough. And that's given people the headspace to think about social issues in a new way, to think about Black Lives Matter, to think about decolonization and what does it mean. I think there's a whole raft of PhD theses to be written about the impact of no professional sports in the world for 4 months. And what does this do for the gender balance and the psychological balance of a population? So I think that we need to also see that the interactivity of the internet, the growing use of IR and AR, mean that the on-site experience will be even better. We should embrace this. Because we already know more people go to museums than go to sports. And so this is something that can definitely increase exponentially if we work with new technology in a positive way.
Mm-hmm. All right.
And the money will follow. You know, money always follows good ideas. It's when our ideas become stale that the money falls away, to be frank with you.
That's true. That's absolutely true. I think, Norbert, you all, Sabine, you all have to run, or can I still take one question from the audience?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, the last question, and we cannot take one more. Could the speakers address how they will engage in a more inclusive, equitable, and diverse art community in their reopening plans? Somehow, some of you touched already a little bit on that theme, but I think it's an important question. That's why I wanted to take it on.
Maybe when I start. So I think the key is digitization. A French newspaper wrote that the digital channels of the Vienna Tourist Board were the best ways to the cultural institutions to find to the online offerings of the Viennese cultural institutions. I think that's our role as facilitator. Mm-hmm. And I think this will go on. And so that's what we try to do also in future, to be also in future a facilitator and a promoter of the arts.
Yes.
And maybe to the question before, tourism was affected as one of the first industries, after music industries, by digitization, which was very painful in the beginning. Mm-hmm. Nowadays, every step of the customer journey has its mirroring in the digital world. And Gail was talking about VR and AR. And for only a short period, there were some gurus who would say, AR and VR will replace tourism because people won't travel anymore. The contrary happened, actually. The complete opposite happened. People are traveling more and more. And that's what I would emphasize and to say to institutions, don't be shy to build your digital universe. Mm-hmm. And do whatever you think is necessary to do so. It mm-hmm. will never replace your real-time experience.
Yeah.
And don't be shy about that, because sometimes it's painful, because you need to shift the logic. So what we did, we shifted our logic from an analog logic with some digital satellites to a digital logic with some analog satellites, which is painful sometimes, you know, for people of my generation. But I think it's the best thing you can do.
Sabine, any comments still on this question on more inclusive, more equitable, more diverse art community you want to reach in the future?
Well, I mean, it's obvious. We just have to just improve our audience engagement and just to try to be more democratic, to be more open, to listen more, to try out more. You know, the trial and error. Probably we have to give more room to this. This might be painful for institutions that used to be very successful to go for trial and error and see what is successful and some things might not work out. And I can only underline what Norbert said about the digital ways of addressing audiences. We have to accept that, especially younger generations, you can reach them on the digital way, and once it's interesting enough, they might be happy to experience the non-digital art experience as well. But you should not condemn it and say the digital way of experiencing art is and only the good good way is to come to the museum right away. There are many ways, and you just have to keep trying. And also it's a matter of balancing your resources and keep going.
Okay, the last comment.
Just a last comment. So I'm happy we all embrace this idea of digital. But you know, that also involves a massive reset. We have to re-educate the people who work in museums, and even artists need to be involved in that, because they're always a little bit ahead or a lot ahead. So it's not just to use it, it's also to train our staff to become content producers in a new way. And this is a big, massive investment. So, you know, governments think nothing about investing in the airline industry or investing in the mining. I'm from a mining country. All the problems that is, we have to have massive, serious investment in retraining staff and retaining staff. And I think that this is part of a whole reset. And I'm thrilled that there's been so much agreement on this point, because you are a great cultural country, and maybe you can help lead the way. I noticed Vienna is top 10 of innovation cities in the world. And so I can really look to great international partnership.
Thank you. Thank you, all of you. Sabine Haag, my pleasure. Really, thanks so much for all your insights. Gail Lord, joining us from Toronto, thanks so much for this early hour talk. You joined us. And Norbert Kettner, thanks so much also for your experience, insights, and comments. And see you hopefully soon again in the real world. And I also want to thank our audience, of course, behind the screens, and Nina Eckert and Barbara Wünsch from Vienna Art Week for hosting our session. Thank you, and goodbye in Vienna, hopefully soon.